is grass-fed and grass-finished. We have no feedlots here. None of our cattle gets fed grains at all from start to finish, well, unless some environmental condition comes along and they need it from an animal welfare perspective. But generally speaking, cattle in New Zealand eat grass or hay, and that is their diet. New Zealand is fantastic at producing beef. I would say we are the best in the world. We do it really, really well, and it tastes fantastic. Now, grass-fed beef is important, and that is because cows eat grass. They are ruminants. They are evolved to eat grass. They are not evolved to eat corn and soy and all sorts of other things that they might be fed in a feedlot. That's not their natural diet, and it has negative health impacts for them and for us if we eat the beef that they produce when they're not eating what they're supposed to be eating as a species. Here in New Zealand, we have been producing grass-fed beef from the beginning of the concept of New Zealand as a nation. And we're really, really good at it. We have developed genetics for cattle that work really, really well in this system, to the point that the genetics that we have get exported all around the world so that other countries can take advantage of the hard work that we have done producing cattle that thrive under natural raising conditions. And that is so important. It's important that as an entire globe, we return to producing our food in a way that is sustainable and good for people and animals and the planet. Grass-fed beef is much better for you than grain-fed beef. Of course, because the cows themselves are much healthier because they're not being force-fed a diet that they're not supposed to be eating. But the actual composition of the meat is better for you. It has a better omega 3 to 6 ratio. So those are those good fats that as humans we need to make our brains work well and for our bodies to be healthy. Grain-fed beef has a much higher omega 6 to 3 ratio, which is not good for us. We need those omega 3s, and grass-fed beef delivers that for us. And it's just altogether a more nutritious product. It's a little bit different than grain-fed beef. Now, I have only had grain-fed beef a couple of times in my life when I wasn't in New Zealand. And I have to say, I was not impressed compared to how I've been raised on grass-fed beef, because that is all you can buy here. Every single piece of beef in New Zealand is grass-fed. It doesn't matter whether you buy it at the supermarket, it doesn't matter if it's the cheapest cut available or the fanciest. It is grass-fed, birth to death. So you just can't get grain-fed. And when I tried grain-fed beef, I was like, I don't even think this is beef. I don't know what I'm eating, but it does not taste like what I understood beef to be at the time. So it is different. And from that perspective, it can be a bit challenging to work with if you've never worked with it before. It's leaner than grain-fed beef because the cows are out walking around, moving, doing all the things they're supposed to be doing. And it takes up much longer for a grass-fed cattle beast to finish. So about 30 months maybe from birth to the slaughterhouse to get that. And a grain-finished animal can finish in like 12 months, 15 months. So they're younger when they get processed. So there is a difference in time and age of animal, and that does influence how the meat behaves when you cook it. Grass-fed beef is a little less forgiving to cook than grain-fed beef. So I've already mentioned it's a bit leaner, and that means that if you cook it too quickly or you're a bit too rough with it, then it's going to dry out and become tough much more quickly than a grain-fed beef will. So you do have to understand how to cook it. You've got to treat it right, and you've got to cook it appropriately for the cut of beef that you have. Now we've talked about how important grass-fed beef is, we're going to talk about grain-fed beef. Now, we've ended up in a situation where grain-fed beef is the most common system of raising beef for people to eat, which is kind of bonkers. We've taken an animal that thrives on grass, which people can't eat, and we've turned it into an animal that we cram into a feedlot and feed grain, which people can eat, which when you stop and think about it is completely bonkers, ridiculous. It's also really bad for the cattle in those systems because they're supposed to be eating grass or hay, but grass products. Now they do get fed a little bit of that in the feedlots because they have to for their health, but most of what they're eating is soy and corn and whatever else is cheap to feed them to get them fat fast, which is pretty terrible in my opinion. Now, all cattle start off their lives out on the range somewhere. When they're calves with their mothers, they are out eating grass on the range or in paddocks and pastures, but they get moved to feedlots to finish. And depending on how big they need to be and what breed they are, they're going to be there for different amounts of time. But most countries around the world finish off beef by cramming them into feedlots and feeding them grain. Now, coming from my perspective here as someone from New Zealand, where we have no feedlots and you can go for a drive and see the beautiful cattle out on the pastures eating and getting fat, which is really heartwarming, it's really mind-boggling to me that we would raise cattle any other way. So how did we end up with this system? Well, it's kind of political. So what happens is corn and soy in particular are heavily subsidized and they are grown in massive quantities and huge surpluses so that the market actually gets manipulated. The price is so low because of the massive surpluses produced and the subsidies paid to the farmers to produce that massive surplus that we end up with all of this corn and soy that has to go somewhere because people couldn't possibly eat all of it. And it's not really that nutritious for people to be eating it in the first place. So we decided to feed it to animals. Now people can eat this, but also the land being used to grow these massive monocultures of corn and soy could be used to grow other things, more nutritious things for people. But because of the systems in place, the legislation around it, how the whole system has been set up to work, it's really hard for farmers to choose to grow other things. Their livelihood could be on the line if they try to do a different thing. So it's not the fault of the farmer that we have this system. They're just stuck, locked into the system, which is really unfair for them. It's unfair for the cattle, and it's unfair for us as consumers buying and eating the subpar food. Monoculture farming, so by that I mean growing hectares upon hectares of just one crop, is really bad for the ecosystem, it's bad for the soil, and that means it's going to be bad for people and animals and the planet. It depletes nutrients in the soils, it causes topsoil to degrade or blow away, and it destroys habitat for other things that used to live there. So from that perspective, growing massive amounts of corn and soy isn't the best choice. And like I said, we produce so much of it. It is in such a surplus that it's apparently cheap enough to feed to cattle who can actually eat grass, which people can't eat. So just keep that in mind, how ridiculous this system is. Because of these massive surpluses that are produced, and these are produced globally, it's not just one country that is at fault here. Massive corn and soy is just grown all around the globe, so huge surpluses. And that means that the price is really, really low, which means that the farmers aren't able to get enough money from selling their crops to actually make a living. And that's where governments step in to offer subsidies for the farmers so they can keep growing it. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't give farmers a hand. They do absolutely fantastic work and we need them to do it, otherwise everybody would starve. So it is not a fault of the farmers. It is the fault of legislation driving behavior in a certain direction that's not actually good for us. So it's really important that we start to decouple our systems from just this insanity and start moving them back to things that work more in harmony with nature. Now, I'm not saying that this is a simple thing to unpack. It's not as simple as just taking all the cows that are currently in feedlots and putting them out on pasture. The pastures for that many cows don't actually really exist. So we have to slowly step ourselves back into a more sensible situation. The cows that are being used for grain finishing actually are different. They've been bred to thrive under this situation, or at least to gain weight quickly under this situation. And if you put them out on grass, they're actually not going to do very well. We need the small, compact kind of cattle, like we have here in New Zealand, that can thrive under the system of being out on pasture from start to finish. So it's not as simple as just saying, oh, this is now the right way forward. It's going to take time. But we as consumers, when we buy meat, we have the choice of what kind of system we want to support. And I think it's absolutely essential that we use the money that we're going to spend on meat to nourish ourselves and our families, that we point that in the right direction and support farmers who are trying their best to bring us food that is good for us and good for the farmer and good for ecosystems and everything on the planet. Ruminant animals like cattle, sheep, goats, deer, they're super important to grasslands. Grass needs ruminant animals to graze it, and ruminant animals should be grazing grass. They're massively important to grassland ecosystems all over the globe. If we didn't have ruminant animals grazing down the grass, then the forests would come in and take those grasslands back over. So the prairies and the savannas, they would slowly over time just turn into forests. So from that perspective, cattle are super important and can be used to restore and maintain grassland ecosystems. And of course, they're much happier doing that than being crammed into feedlots. So it's really important to remember that while some people like to say that cows are ruining everything, they're actually not if they're being farmed appropriately. When cattle are grazed on well-managed grassland systems, they actually improve the ecosystem where they are in. Like I mentioned earlier, grasslands need ruminant animals to be grazing them. It's how they thrive and stay stable and able to support other animals in them. So when we utilize systems copying nature to graze our cattle, we are not making negative impacts to our environment. We are in fact making positive impacts. So when you hear people say, oh, we need to stop eating red meat and cows are terrible for the planet and we should stop having cattle, that is not true under well-managed grassland systems. Grasslands can be massively diverse. They can have thousands of species in them, like massive diverse polycultures that can support habitat for many other things. The soil health improves, water infiltration improves, topsoil is not lost, and grasslands can store massive amounts of carbon, sometimes even more than forests can if they're really, really mature and well-managed grasslands, which is crazy. So we can use cattle to maintain habitat for other species, improve the ecosystem, and store carbon in the soil. All of these are fantastic things, which would be great even if the cows were not providing us with anything other than grazing our grasslands. But they do provide us with other things. They provide us with fantastic healthy beef, and they can provide us with milk and the other products that cattle can provide. So fantastic. It's a win-win solution for everybody and something that we absolutely should be moving towards. Depending on where you live in the world, it might be a bit challenging to find grass-fed, grass-finished beef. But what you probably can find is New Zealand grass-fed beef. So I'm going to shamelessly plug my country here. Go out and find some. I'm going to link in the description a place where you can go and find it if you're in the United States. But you can find it wherever you are. We export around the world. Try New Zealand beef, and then you're going to know what it's supposed to taste like. And then try and find a grass-fed supplier in your own country, because you want to be supporting the farmers that are supplying you.